Hi, I'm
Hi.
Bill Wong with Electronic Design, and we're going to be taking a look at an interesting neural processing unit from BrainChip. So, Steve, could you tell us a little bit about why we're taking a different, or you're taking a different approach to this?
Sure. I'm looking forward to kind of giving you our viewpoint on this. I think everybody has always looked at AI as a data-driven problem. And we kind of looked at this at the most elementary level, kind of bring it up at a top level and then drill down. We always look at the four elements of AI. It's, data, software, hardware, and energy, and how they interrelate to creating an AI solution. If you own these four elements, you basically can create artificial intelligence. The question is, what's the methodology that you do this? Typically, companies start with their data sets. They start building models in software on cloud solutions, and then they try to figure out how to port that into hardware at the edge. And the result is they'll get a certain amount of energy consumption through that exercise. Our customers have come back to us and said, look, we have a very specific energy requirement, and we would really like to know what you can do with our data within that energy budget. So we worked the reverse approach where we start with the energy budget. We look at a minimal hardware configuration to hit that energy budget. And then how can we optimize the software to use that data more effectively to hit the overall solution?
Now, when you're talking about the energy budget, you're talking about ultra low power. The new Akido Pico that you have is designed to work on a fraction of a battery. So you can talk a little bit about the point that you're targeting with these things.
Sure. I think the key here is that we want to scale the AI to the energy requirements. So it takes a little discussion to understand what that means. There's a couple of different battery capacities that are really commonly used in the industry. If we look at a wireless earbud, that's about 50 milliamp hours per earbud. If we have the advanced pro noise canceling earbuds, they might be up to 100 milliamp hours. And then we might have a battery powered device. We put a AA battery in there. That battery, to last for 1 year, it needs to really have as low as, under 300 microamps of current. So we're talking about microwatt operation for these functions. So the Akido Pico core is really designed to run in that microwatt to milliwatt power range that will extend the usage beyond just a daily usage to weekly charging, or in some larger battery configurations, operate for an entire year without changing the battery.
Now, these things are designed to work in conjunction with very low power microcontrollers. Could you talk about some of the applications that this can be targeting?
Of course. I mean, right now, a lot of companies use microcontrollers for these devices, and they augment that using software to do their AI or have a small, neural processing element next to it. What we've seen is that to get below the power levels of those types of solutions, you almost need a very specific neural network implementation that can drive you to the next level of power efficiency. So we actually use a systematic approach to get a minimal configuration of our Akida core to produce this Akida Pico. And then even then, we had to augment that with more specialized neural network algorithms on top of it to get the power efficiency targets that the customers were looking for.
Now, some of the applications that you were doing, essentially taking an existing model, and you came up with a modified RNN to make things work.
That's right. We call it TENS, or temporally event-based neural networks. So it actually has a notion of time in it, and it's a derivative of a what's called a state-space network. It's kind of the next generation architecture after transformers. But we found it to be particularly valuable for the edge because it reduces the number of multiply accumulates, and it also reduces the amount of memory parameters that are needed to get a high quality network performance.
Now, one of the application spaces you're looking at are things like earbuds, where denoising is an application. Could you tell us a little bit about how this would work in that space?
I'd love to do that. And the denoising solution that we worked on, we actually looked at the state-of-the-art kind of solutions. This was Deep Filter Net version 3. And that combined a combination of digital signal processing plus CNN algorithms to convert the signal into the frequency domain with an FFT. do a CNN network on it and convert it back to the time domain with an inverse FFT. We actually use an integrated single model, our TENS model for this. There's a paper that we published called Attenuate, which talks about how to attenuate noise using this new TENS architecture that was able to reduce the number of multiple accumulators by 1/10 over the conventional deep filtered net 3 and reduce the number of memory parameters by 1/3, all running on the Akido Pico. The attractive thing is we actually got higher quality results than the state-of-the-art deep filter network. So we reduced the power with less multiplies, we reduced the cost by requiring less memory, and we improved the subjective quality through testing. So it was a trifecta, as you might call it, in the business.
Okay. Now, in terms of the core, it's very tiny, about 150K logic gates. And is there a way to evaluate that now? Can it be put into an FPGA, for example?
Perfect question. Thank you so much. It is a very economical core. It's 150,000 gates without the memory. You can configure the local RAM around it based on the amount of parameters that you might need for the network model and the amount of buffering you need for the data stream coming in. But the basic core itself is 150,000 gates that comes out to slightly more than 1/10 of a square millimeter in a 22 nanometer process. When we add enough memory to do some of the keyword spotting use case we have, it goes up to 0.2 square millimeters. If we add enough memory for the audio denoising, it comes up to about 0.5 square millimeters in 22 nanometers. The beauty of this is that it's a soft IP core, so we can synthesize this to FPGA targets. We're providing a customers an evaluation on the Xilinx FPGAs with the soft implementation of the Akido Pico.
Well, very good. Well, before we wrap up, could you briefly talk about the underlying architecture? Because this uses something called spiking neural networks that are slightly different than the more conventional CNNs that a lot of people are more familiar with.
That's right. And I think that has been a lot of the challenges of understanding the benefits of the brain chip solution, because we took a completely different approach than most of the marketplace. So we kind of contrast the Akido architecture, which was inspired by the brain to use spiking neural networks, as opposed to the standard DLAs that are out in the market that use strictly convolutional operations using matrix multiplication. So the Akido IP does convolution in the event domain. And the event domain is an easy way of saying it's a spiking network. So a spiking network is accumulating the values of the weights times the data until it exceeds a threshold or an activation function, and it either passes that data to the next layer of the network or it has a zero output. And the beauty is it doesn't pass anything to the next layer network. So all those future computations that result might participate in are no longer needed, and we can reschedule dynamically the execution of an algorithm so that we're not doing null multiply accumulates, which is a waste of power, essentially. If we look at a conventional CNN with matrix multiplications, the matrix multiplier is a very effective way to do matrix math, but there's no way to reschedule any of those inner calculations if there are zeros in them. So they just calculate them all irregardless of the value of the weights and the activation sparsity, and you get what I call more of a brute force approach to calculating CNNs. The beauty of that approach is it's very easy to program, and you can schedule this before you execute the onto the matrix multiplier. Some customers or some companies that use convolutional matrix multiplication, they can find those zeros in advance and they can remove them into the scheduling on the compiler so that the resulting image can take advantage of some of these zeros. The one unique advantage of the Akido IP is if there's any zeros in the data, then we can drop those out, whereas there is no way to dynamically schedule these matrix multipliers to eliminate the multiply accumulate of zero values. We also have flexibility in the precision of our weights and activations. We can do 2, 4, 8 bits of weights and activations, and typically a standard solution will use 8 bits or more of that. The other advantages is that we do a lot of what we call at-memory event-based computation, meaning that we're moving the data through the array of elements with memory inside of those computational elements. So that reduces the amount of pinging back and forth between large consolidated memories that might be on the outside of a conventional matrix multiplication engine.
Very good. Well, thanks, Steve, for filling us in on the Akido Pico and spiking neural networks.